you now have a show on HBO, you know, for people who think that you live on this couch.
Hey!
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
And this, of course, is not your first HBO appearance.
No, absolutely not.
You were, of course, on Oz.
Correct.
And on The Sopranos.
Yes, sir.
Now, The Sopranos episode, I don't quite remember.
It was, you know, there's not a lot of black people on The Sopranos, so
right.
It was one episode, me and my man, shout out to Trigger Tretch, was in this episode.
Okay.
Where I basically played a rapper who was, I guess they was trying to act like I was like a 50 Cent type of individual who ended up getting shot. And when he got shot, him getting shot helped his record sales. Mm. Okay.
Oh, I think I do remember.
So now Tretch was a rapper that I was supposed to be working with and bringing him up. So now he's like, damn, I might not even pop now because of what he's doing. So one of the gangster guys is like, yo, I could shoot you too now.
I remember that.
The episode is called Fleshy Part of the Thigh. So they end up shooting Tretch in the ass, like out somewhere in the hood, you know, and he's hopping around. It was a hilarious scene.
Okay.
And, yeah.
So did you actually get to work with Tony Soprano?
Yeah, I worked straight with Gandolfini. Found out we were born on the same day, September 17th. Also worked with another legend, Hal Holbrook was in the scene. Do your Googles on Hal Holbrook if you don't know who that is. He's a legendary actor that you've seen in millions of things.
Now, what was it like working with Tony Soprano? Because that was like, you know, because that was really his show.
Right.
Yes, all the other characters were brilliant, but really, it was Tony Soprano's show.
Yo, he was the nicest guy. Like, there was no, you know, Tony Soprano shit about him. Like, you know what I mean? He was just crazy cool to work with, giving out compliments and just, you know, he didn't make you feel like he was on some star shit. You know what I mean? Like, he was actually, from his trailer to the set, he was riding like a bike and shit. You know what I mean? I guess trying to get his little exercise and shit.
Right,
you know?
And he passed way too young. What was he, like maybe 50 or something?
Something like that, yeah.
Very young. I mean, this is why we gotta
watch your weight, watch you eat.
Yeah.
Get exercise, balance it out. Can't do everything wrong. You know?
Exactly, exactly. And of course, you were on Oz for how many seasons?
I did 12 episodes, so it was like a season and a half.
Okay. Now, how did you end up getting on this new HBO series, The Night Of?
I auditioned for it. You know, I got a lovely manager that I've been working with for years now. Shout out Lillian LaSalle. And she gets me in front of certain places where I need to be, and then I just do the work from there. You know,
okay.
They're not putting me in because I'm a platinum rapper or even a gold rapper. You know what I mean? They put me in there because I do the work. I be knowing my lines, I show up on time, professional with my shit, so.
Cool. Now, there are other rappers on this HBO series as well.
Tretch is on this again.
Again.
Sticky Fingers is in this.
Yep.
Actually, the guy who plays the lead, my man, his name is Riz, I think Riz Ahmed is his real name. He's from London, he's like a, you know, I don't know, I want to say some sort of Indian, Pakistan, or something like that. But he rhymes himself, actually. He's nice, too. Like, he's known over in England and shit.
Yeah.
We don't know about him over here, so. You know, I guess when you're doing the jail thing and all of that, rappers add a certain authenticity to it, you know.
Yeah.
Like, definitely Sticky plays a little goon in this, you know what I mean?
Right.
But, yeah. You know, it's a little different for me because they got me on the other side of the law.
Right, you're actually playing a prison guard.
A CO, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Now, I know the series is not out yet, so, you know, I'm sure you've signed some certain paperwork about, you know, letting them apply.
Well, I don't even, like, you know, I know about it, but I don't even know all that much about it. Like, I didn't get the whole script. And all that.
What's the general premise of this series, and why is it called The Night Of?
The general premise is it's about this guy that's, I guess, Pakistani type American who is accused of like a murder or rape. Now, we don't know if he did it or not, I don't know, but he's accused of it. But he's like a real square type of dude. So it kind of shows, you know, how you get into jail. It's easy to get in, but it's hard to get out, kind of, you know? And it shows his little transformation of, you know, how he comes in there and how he ends up I don't know if he gets out. To be honest, like, I don't know the whole story, to be honest.
But so is it like, is each, is it a series of continuing stories, or is each
It's episode? One story. It's one story. So it's a mini series, but it's 8 episodes
okay.
spread out for one story.
Okay, so it's one story mm-hmm. On 8 episodes
right.
on HBO, which has an impeccable record when it comes to the stuff they put out.
Yeah, I mean, the director and the writer, you know, this guy wrote like Gods and Kings, the Egypt shit. He wrote Lady with the Dragon Tattoo, Schindler's List.
Oh, wow.
He has writer's credits on, okay? Like
okay.
Yeah, this guy's serious.
Big like, Hollywood yeah, yeah. stuff.
And one of the guys that was directing, like when I first got there, the first episode I did, he just did that The Theory of Everything. He mm-hmm. directed that Stephen Hawking's movie. That
oh, right, yeah, I saw that.
Nominated for
an Oscar.
Yeah, and all of that. So, dope. Yeah, it's some big John Turturro's in it.
Yeah.
Got to work with him, too.
Right, oh, he's dope.
Yeah,
so. Yeah, no, absolutely.
It was dope, it was beautiful.
You know, like a lot of people want to get into acting. And, you know, as someone who's been acting for a while, you actually... You know, because I've done a little bit of TV stuff here and there, and I know the cool part, you know, which is different from reality shows, when you actually are acting on a TV series or a movie or whatever else, you actually sign with the Screen Actors Guild. So you actually make money every time the show is rebroadcast. So you're actually getting checks from Oz and from Sopranos and stuff like that. This is the advantage of actually being part of these types of productions.
Yeah. And it's like, I mean, over time, the checks get smaller and smaller.
Right, because it gets broadcast less.
Just like anything.
Yeah.
But shit, the first time it come on, you get that first check, it's damn near what you got paid for the shit. So you'd be like, oh, hell yeah.
Right.
It's beautiful. You know what I mean? And then, yeah, you got enough shows under your belt. You're getting checks, you know what I mean, from multiple things. You know what I mean?
For years. When it gets picked up. Overseas and
whatever. Oh, any kind of syndication show. If you're lucky enough to get on a show that's syndicated, which I've been on quite a few, that's all right.
Have you ever taken any like acting lessons or anything else like that?
No, I never. Haven't actually. No,
so you just walked in and just, I'm gonna do me?
You know, I've always studied it. You know, I'm a scientist. So I'll look at something, take it apart in my mind, put it back together. So I've always been studying acting for a long time. It's something I wanted to do for a long time, but I just didn't really know how to get into it. Then when I kind of just spoke it out to the universe, that's when shit just started coming to me.
Right. Because you know I mean? I know, for example, like 50 Cent was taking acting classes. Like
right.
He was really like boom, boom, boom.
Right.
You know, that's how he's able to do films like De Niro, Pacino, and stuff like that. You never felt like it was necessary for you to... take it, you know, like, okay, I'm going to get an acting coach. I'm really going to start really going extra hard on it because it is very lucrative if you can get in the right situations.
Right. I mean, I've thought about it, but at the same time, it's like the one who I call my acting coach is Eamon Walker. Okay. That's the guy that played Saeed on Oz.
Okay.
Okay. Like, he took dudes to the side, not just me. But like he took dudes to the side and made sure that we was prepared when we was in a scene. You know what I mean? Especially the black actors, like, because a lot of times, you know, to be honest, they take more time for the white actors' scenes. You understand? Make sure they get it right. They let us do our show. Okay, yeah, let's move on. Nah. And he wasn't having that type of shit.
Right.
He was like, let's make sure we get this shit right. Because they already know they might cut our time. So the first day, he had like a bunch of us, even some extra type dudes that was going to be in the scene, come in there and practice. After that, I started going like to lunch with him, and me and him was talking. He's like, yo, you're a natural, B. He said he never went to acting class.
Mm.
Okay? And he's done Othello. You know what I mean? He's like, I'm telling you, you're a natural at this. Just keep doing the knowledge. Keep, you know what I mean? The best class... is just experience, just doing. Like anybody can go to school for something and all of that, for business. The best business class is to just open a business. Acting class is to be on a production with professional people, watch what they're doing, and allow their greatness to bring you up.
Yeah. Like, for example, I've never taken a film class, but I've had, you know, films on Showtime. I had a documentary on Showtime, on MTV. You know, I did one of the episodes of American Gangster on BET. Like, yeah, a lot of it is just throwing yourself in with the right people and having the right types of ideas.
And having the confidence to say you can do it.
Exactly.
Like, I've directed videos too before. Like, you know what I mean? Just right. Because I felt, yeah, I can do that.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I do my studying, but as far as any formal training, no.
No. Well, anyways, congratulations on the series. I'm definitely hyped
to see it come
out. You know, when's it dropping?
June 10th.
Oh, shit.
No, July 10th.
July 10th. Next month.
Yeah.
That's what it is. Okay, last time we talked, we actually had our live event.
Right.
Fife Dawg had just died.
Yeah.
Since then, Prince has died. And we actually had just announced that they found the cause of death. What is an opioid, anyways?
An opiate. Drugs, basically.
Okay.
Heroin is an opiate. Cocaine is an opiate. All these drugs, you know, Vicodin or Percocet and all these type of things are opiates.
Number one, how do you feel about Prince's death?
I mean, whenever somebody, you know, dies, which seems to be prematurely, you know, before what we feel should be their time.
He was like 50-something, right?
Yeah. 57. It's crazy. You know what I mean? It's just like, it's surprising. It's shocking. You know what I mean? Prince was a hell of an entertainer, man.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? He was a hell of an entertainer.
Yeah, because like last night in my hotel room, they were playing the Purple Rain movie.
Right.
And seeing him on stage was like, I haven't seen the movie in so long. And it was like, wow, this guy. It's like, you know, you just see the difference. You go to a rap show, you see the dude just walking up and down the stage and his hype man doing half his lyrics and it's super lame.
And you maybe see, somebody wrote the song for him.
Right. And you see this dude and it's like, he's dancing and it's choreographed with the rest of the band.
He can
and they
play
have
every
these,
instrument.
Yeah.
He wrote and arranged the songs.
It's
one thing to write the lyrics, but then the arrangement and instrumentation of something is a whole next level.
And like, I mean, he was performing a lot of the songs from the Purple Rain soundtrack, and it was like just the music itself was like, God damn, you forgot how just different it was.
Right.
From everything of that time. You know, it was very different from the Michael Jackson stuff,
right,
which was his biggest competitor during that time. Right. And even just the movie itself, conceptually, was just like completely like out there. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Prince was on another level.
Although I gotta say, like, you know, I always like, he was one that forced me to be able to separate music from the person. You know, because I wasn't feeling his style. Let's keep it real. Like, you know what I mean? All this pink, purple lace and all that type of shit. Like, come on. That's not something that we fucked with. You know what I mean?
Right.
But I can appreciate his musicianship, his showmanship, him being an entertainer. You know what I mean? But when he was on covers laying up butt-ass naked looking like a girl and shit, it was like, what the fuck is that?
Well, he actually wore chaps with ass hanging out.
This is what I'm telling you, like all of that type of crazy shit. And it's ironic that the two biggest black male stars both had some sort of androgyny type shit going on about them.
Michael Jackson, you felt was androgynous?
Well, he wasn't masculine. He wasn't masculine. He was going for something which is called androgyny, somewhere in between man and woman. Where it's kind of
Michael Jackson,
confusing.
I mean, well, he was, number one, he had a very skinny build.
So right? What?
Well, okay, yeah. You're
so skinny. What?
I guess you and Michael Jackson had somewhat of a similar.
No, come on, I'll take my shirt off right now. He ain't got no fucking bumps on his chest. Like,
right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Like,
fair enough. But I mean, yeah, I mean, he wore a lot of the glitter and stuff like that.
Come on, makeup and all this funny type of shit. Like,
right.
It was just, you know, and I'm not trying to down these people. I'm just telling you, I wasn't really feeling either one of them when they was getting on there, you know, on that funny shit. But I could, as somebody who of lover of music, I could say, yo, those motherfuckers is dope. They made some dope shit. I can't front on that.
Right.
You know what I mean? But I'm not fucking with your attire and your, you know what I mean? Although Prince, he had the broad speed.
Right.
Out of all of that, he still let you know, listen.
I'm fucking.
I got some badass bras. Like, there's a method behind my madness. And some of us had to respect it. Like, okay, I hear you. I wouldn't do that to get broads. You see what I'm saying? But you do you.
In New York at the time, did you see dudes try to emulate Prince? Like, dress like Prince and had the hair like Prince and stuff like that?
Only funny style dudes. Nobody that, you know what I mean? I saw more people try to do like Michael Jackson than Prince, you know?
Okay.
Like, I saw some dudes wear the jacket, you know? That might have been like, you know, a regular dude kind of, but he had the zipper jacket or whatever. You had that jacket, right?
I think I wanted that jacket, but my mom couldn't afford it. But I was like in elementary school.
I didn't even want it.
I mean, you're talking like literally like early elementary
school. You had bombers and sheepskins and shit. That's what I wanted. That's what I had. But yeah, nah, I can't say that I saw like a bunch of Prince wannabes running around. But I'm sure they was out there. It's just I wouldn't have seen them.
It was kind of hard to emulate Prince. Like it was just hard to pull that off. Like in regular life. Like, you know what I mean? Like
right, high heels.
Well, just the hair. Well, what, you know, and I tried to look up what nationality Prince was, and he never really talked about it. I guess he was part black, part Italian, part something, part Puerto Rican, part like you didn't quite know.
If you go by the movie with the way he portrays in the movie, it almost looks like his mother could be half white and his father was black. You know what I mean? Because the mother definitely is, you know, in the movie.
Yeah,
she's black, but she's very light skinned, so it could have been one of those. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I feel like they might be trying to shit on him right now with all this drug shit. First of all, I was in there for the autopsy. I don't trust y'all bastards. Nothing y'all got to say, okay? You could say he died of opioids and all this type of shit. I don't know that. You know what I mean? And I don't take nothing on face value. You know what I mean?
Well, to die at 57 when you look like you're in decent shape.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, okay, if like one of the fat boys dying in his 40s, all right, I get it.
Yeah.
He was
overweight,
morbidly obese.
Mm-hmm.
I got it. Like, I've definitely heard of a lot of people, you know, Heavy D dying early. It's like, okay, I get it. This is an unhealthy weight. You know, your organs are being squeezed and pushed, mm-hmm. and over time they just give up. But Prince kind of looked the same. You know, when you see Prince in his various appearances, he looked like Prince from Purple Rain.
Right, and he didn't look like Prince the drug addict either.
No, he did not look like
Prince. There's a lot of people that you can visibly see, yo, that motherfucker on drugs. Like, he's fucked up.
Like, when you see DMX, you're like,
something could be going
on. Something could be going on. Okay,
but what I'm saying is, we can't ignore what people are also talking about, how Prince was in a battle for his masters and all this type of shit, and he might have...
But Prince had his masters.
Well, there was some shit that he just recently, from what I understand, he just recently won some sort of fight he was having against whatever, was it Warner Brothers or one of these motherfuckers that he was down with.
Well, remember at one point he did that video and it had like slave written mm-hmm. on his face.
Like, he's been battling these motherfuckers for years. Michael Jackson's been battling motherfuckers for years. Bill Cosby was supposed to be doing some shit, and now they on him. What's going on?
Right.
Like, I gotta just put that out there. I don't know if it's true or not, but we gotta put that out there. And if that is out there, that means we can't just take on face value whatever the fuck they tell us.
When you're talking about a collection of music, like Prince, you're talking about something
mad shit.
Right. But even the shit that's already out,
right,
is worth billions of dollars,
right,
over time.
Shit that he's wrote for people, all of that.
Oh yeah. Like Purple Rain will continue to be played 100 years from now.
1999
will continue.
When Doves Cry.
Doves Cry, Purple Rain, Little Red Corvette. It just goes on and on. Prince was a very unique talent, and it was definitely interesting how he came around. I know we're reaching out to Little Richard right now.
Oh yeah.
Because I guess Little Richard accused Prince of kind of taking his style. You can kind of see it.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, I guess, took from some things from Little Richard.
Yeah.
Prince, James Brown,
James Brown too.
Yeah, Michael Jackson too.
So speaking of Bill Cosby.
Bad for Bill right now, huh?
Right, because you said that Bill ain't going to get convicted of nothing.
I didn't think he was.
But Bill's going to have to stand trial.
That still don't mean he's going to get convicted. They might just drag him all through the mud, make him admit to some shit that he's done, and then, all right, we can't convict you, but now all of this foul shit is out there about you, and in the court of public opinion, you're done.
Well, but that's been out there now. I mean, Bill's been dragged for the past year.
Yeah, but it hasn't fully taken hold. You know what I mean? Like, although he is becoming like, you know, the butt of jokes as far as, oh, you try to Cosby somebody. Like, that's now the new, like, knock somebody out, you know.
Yeah.
With a drink type of shit. Or even just knock them out, period. You know, because we'd be playing the UFC shit on Xbox and shit. And Cosby is like a slang for knocking a nigga out. Man. Hilarious. But anyway.
It's looking bad, though. It looks looking bad for Cosby, and it keeps getting worse. Because I thought by now, all the charges would be done.
Yeah, settlement. All the girls would be falling off like leaves.
Falling off, whatever.
But they're trying to ramp it. And they're saying he can get 10 years. Poor guy. And you see he got cataract right now. Nobody's talking about that.
Right.
Look at this eye. It's turning blue.
Yeah.
He's bumping into shit and all kind of shit.
Right. He's what, in his 80s?
Come on. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, man. It's looking bad for Bill, and I guess his show's been yanked off the air now for a while.
Right. But even though Mr. Pedophile show is still out there, yes?
I think so. Was Seventh Heaven?
Yeah. We talked about this.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say it again. His fucking show is still out there.
Yeah.
And his shit is confirmed. He admitted it.
Exactly.
What about this fuck boy from Glee? He getting residual checks right now. From Glee playing in syndication some fucking where in San Francisco or some fucking where.
Right.
You dig? Why his show ain't off the air?
I guess the argument would be that it's not his show. He's just a character on a show. Whereas Cosby, it was the Cosby show. He was the main focus of the show.
I could argue that was NBC's show. Mm. It just had his name on it.
Right.
There's degrees to everything.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Why? I'll tell you why they won't take Glee down for no fucking reason. Because they need a show like that to help invigorate the LGBT, whatever the how many letters they got in it, community.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That helps strengthen, you know, Modern Family, fucking, all those type of shows help to strengthen and reinforce this shit they're trying to shove down our throats.
So Glee is a gay show?
Yeah, it's a gay show.
I've never watched Glee, so I don't know.
I never watched it either, but I know it's a gay show. I know it's like it got a lot of gays on there.
Oh, really?
And it appeals to gays, you know what I mean?
Like, really?
Gays were always into like...
Theater
and shit like that. That's what made a lot of people not want to fuck with it. Like when I was young, I wanted to get in some acting shit, but when I saw the kind of people that was fucking with theater, I don't want to do that.
Well, in fact, if you go back like to like Shakespeare times,
mm-hmm. Men would play women.
Men would play women. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there were no women who were basically allowed to act in plays.
You know, what kind of gay shit is that?
That's some gay shit.
Like you just want to be around men the whole time. No, no, no. You got perfectly willing women that want to come in there and play a woman's part. No.
I never understood that part.
I want Larry to do it.
Put on this wig.
Yeah, come here. Give me a hit. Give me a kiss. Let's hug.
Yeah, Romeo and Juliet was two men.
See what I'm saying? They say that your man Shakespeare was gay.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Shakespeare was gay.
This is what they say. I don't know. I wasn't there, but this is what I hear.
Yeah, Romeo and Juliet was performed
originally
by two men. Mm-hmm. Othello, two all men. Macbeth,
all of that.
All men. I wonder why. I mean, because this is...
You know why.
I mean, outside of that, it's kind of like, okay, like...
What was their excuse for
it? Yeah, I mean, because, you know, women's rights did not come until centuries later. I got that. But this is not work. This is art. This is performance. Like, why do you care if a woman performs? Like... They're not voting. They're not whatever.
I mean,
like,
I guess you can get.
They're not in politics.
A certain degree of power. You know, a lot of artists have a certain degree of power. Whether you write books or you're an actor or you're a painter.
Right.
You know, a lot of the painters of that time were men and shit like that. You
right.
understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. You never hear of great female painters. Period. Even today, you don't really hear of great.
I'm sure they're out there.
But you know, I collect art, for example. Like I'm a Keith Haring fan.
Right.
I have a bunch of Keith Haring pieces. But like when I think of like all the great painters, you know, Haring, Warhol, Picasso,
Van Gogh,
Rembrandt.
Mm-hmm. Michelangelo.
All,
yeah.
I mean, but even when you go like modern, Damien Hirst. Murakami, these are all men. All of, you know, when I go to like, you know, Museum of Modern Art and everything else like that, I see a bunch of men doing paintings. And I don't think there's anything inherent in a man that allows him to paint better than a woman.
I think it has to do with the inherent what's the word I'm looking for? Like, there's a certain thing in European society that they feel like you're coming for my power, whether it be his own woman, whether it be, you know, people from outside of their culture. There's this, oh no, it's mine, it's all mine. Like, you're not fucking with this. Like, you know what I mean? I'm gonna get the praise for this shit. Like,
Yeah. That's
a constant theme. It's an insecurity. That's the fucking word I was looking for. So easy. It's a certain insecurity and neuroses within a lot of European psychology mindset that is pervasive within all areas. Politics, religion.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But even if you
the look arts.
At, but even if you look at great American artists, like I said, Warhol, Haring, Basquiat.
Right. Well, this is still a European mind state.
Who's, all men.
Who's running America?
You go to Japan, biggest Japanese artist, Murakami.
I bet you I could find, we go to Africa, I bet you we could find many African artists, okay, female artists.
Really?
From ancient times.
You think?
I can almost guarantee it because we treated our women as partners, not as battle of the sexes.
Okay.
You see? Like the European man specifically took the woman out of the Trinity. Like the original Trinity was man, woman, child. Asar, Aset, and Heru. That's the original Trinity. Then Europeans come along and decide it's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You see what I'm saying? Where's the woman at?
Right.
This is now a Shakespearean play. Okay? Right. And they say your man Shakespeare might have been one of the people that helped write the King James Version.
I can see that.
Of the Bible. Which is why there's a lot of hatred and negativity towards the woman in the Bible. Try to blame her for a bunch of shit.
I mean, although Mary is worshipped in certain sects of Christianity.
Mary, oh yeah, but not Mary Magdalene. They try to call her a whore.
No, the mother of Jesus.
Right, and Mary Magdalene, I mean, we could all debate whether these people were even real.
Yeah.
But if it was, she very well may have been Jesus' wife.
Mm. Mm, yeah.
Okay? But you got males who decide, no, we're going to take that out. We're going to actually even call her a whore.
Right.
And she wasn't the prostitute that was even in the line. Like, yeah. But somehow she got tagged with the stigma of being a prostitute that Jesus somehow cleaned up.
Hmm. Well, me and my man were actually talking about this earlier today, of how history is written by the victors. Whoever ended up on top. You know, because like, for example, he was telling me about this dude named Pop the Brown Hornet,
mm-hmm.
who I guess was the original Wu-Tang dude, and there was a whole, he was telling about this whole, because you know, he's from Staten Island, there's a whole history of Wu-Tang before the Wu-Tang that we're familiar with. I guess the UMCs had mentioned Wu-Tang on their album.
Okay.
And there's a whole Wu-Tang thing that was around before, you know, RZA, GZA, all them other dudes. And some of these dudes is upset, I heard, about, like, yo, like, we original Wu-Tang, and, you know, we need to get the story out there. But the reality is, Wu-Tang made such an impact on the world.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, the Wu-Tang logo became the most recognizable logo in all of hip-hop.
Right.
Period. That anyone who comes and tries to change the story around is just going to get ignored.
Right. And I hear that part of it, but the foul part is when, is if the Wu-Tang that we know now would have went out of their way to cover up the fact that there was an earlier Wu-Tang. You see, they didn't do that. They just let the strength of what they fucking did shine.
Right.
And so now the earlier Wu-Tang might get overshadowed.
Yeah.
But it's not like you going onto the internet and trying to pull everything down that you ever found about. You see what I'm saying? And that's the difference how these motherfuckers do.
Yeah. I feel you.
Mm-hmm.
Derek Fisher was recently in the news. The basketball player?
Four.
He lost a court case against his ex-wife where between spousal support and child support, he now has to pay $109,000 a month, $1.3 million a year.
Damn.
They have like four kids together.
Okay.
But $1.3 million a year. God damn.
Well, how much does he make?
He makes a good amount.
It's all relative.
It's all relative.
Sounds like a lot to me, but 1.3 million, that might not, you know, that's high. But for someone like him, if you're making however much a year, 15 million a year, that ain't shit.
It's still shit, but you know.
That ain't shit, really. Like, come on.
The first number that comes up is 3.4 million.
Is how much he,
that's in 2012.
Or how much he makes?
Salary. His salary was $3.4 million in 2012.
Is he still coaching anywhere? Because the Knicks fired him. Where's he at now?
I'm not sure. I don't know. Hmm. So, but he was making $3.4 million in 2012. So let's just say you adjust that for inflation, maybe 3.6. You're talking about a good third of his income.
Yeah, that's pretty big.
A third.
Oh, no.
Now, when it comes to children, ultimately, your children have to maintain the same type of lifestyle with you that they should have with your ex-wife. They can't come to a mansion when they visit you
and then, go to the projects.
To the projects when they go back to their
home. And neither should she. If she was living with you all this time, that's why they do shit like this.
So you believe in alimony?
To a degree. I don't believe that you should have to go to the courts to do that. I believe it should be some shit that y'all do honorably amongst yourselves.
Yeah, but the reality when it comes to relationships, and this is not always the case, but in a lot of times, when things are over, are done,
mm-hmm.
there's a grab. That happens for the resources.
Doesn't have to be that way. It's just the frame of reference that you have is that once y'all break up, y'all not supposed to get along, and y'all supposed to be fighting over who's who's and what's what, and then motherfuckers, you know, there's a lot of greediness in it. Like, motherfuckers don't want to admit, yo, he helped me or she helped me get to where I'm at, or whatever the case may be. You know what I mean? So, we've been, you know what I mean? Just split the shit up, however the fuck. Like, I'm trying to hold on to, what the fuck you want half of a curling iron, nigga? You don't even, you're bald. You just being an asshole, nigga. Give her a fucking curling iron. You know what I mean? Like, motherfuckers just want to get on some vindictive shit. It don't have to be that way. Like, you know what I mean?
Well, when you had your first, when you had your son, your son's mother and you were never married.
Nope.
Okay. So, after that situation, did she ever take you to court?
Later on, but not right away.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Why later on?
Just birds chirping in her ear. You know what I mean? Hey, you should take that nigga to court. You know what I mean? Well, my son was 13 years old by that time.
Oh, really?
Hell
so
yeah.
So for 13 years, y'all just
it was good money.
Okay.
It was good money. Might have broke up when he was like six. You know what I mean?
Okay.
6 to 13. When I got it, you got it. You know what I mean?
Okay.
And it's like, we don't have to go all of that route. You know what I mean?
Okay. But at 13, she took you to court.
Yeah.
And what happened?
I mean, you know, she had me on it for a second, but I'm not going to get all deep into it. But okay. That didn't last very long.
Okay.
And I'm not on it, you know, now.
How old is your son now?
23, 24.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
Right, because you sometimes see these situations get really bad. Like, for example, you look at the 50 Cent situation, and him and his baby mother are just horrible to each other publicly. Horrible. And he really, like, it goes both ways. It's really kind of painful to watch, because it's like, oh, I really feel sorry, you know, she only got a year left on child support. My son's 17. I'm really wondering what she's going to do after. The reality is, and I remember I was around 50 Cent this one time. I was at G-Unit, and Floyd had just gone through some shit, and he was on the phone with Floyd. And you know, he had mentioned that his baby mother had never worked.
Mm.
Because, you know, at the time he got her pregnant, you know, he was kind of broke or whatever, but then shortly after that, things took off. So you have a situation with a woman who is basing her entire lifestyle off of child support, when technically none of that child support is supposed to be used to maintain the woman's lifestyle. If they were never married, child support is supposed to go strictly to the child.
Mm-hmm.
But
of course,
she is. If you never work for 18 years and you haven't built up a skill set, because you're completely depending on this rich man's child support, what the fuck are you gonna do? You still have many years to live.
Figure it out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But I do believe that if you set her up to the point where she never had to work, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You spoiled her like that. Well, then you set that precedent. You understand? So now when y'all break up and y'all got kids and all of that, like, you can't just, like I said, she can't go from the mansion to the projects like that. Like, you still got to piece her off. You still got to keep her in some sort of position that she's used to living in. You know what I mean? Some sort of way that she's accustomed to living. You know what I mean?
I mean, what happened with your son's mother after the child support stopped? Was she like working the whole time, or?
First of all, it ain't.
You didn't have.
It ain't getting nothing crazy from me. That shit was not changing her life whatsoever.
Right.
Yeah, so she was already doing whatever the hell she was doing. That was just trying to get extras, I guess. You know what I mean? You know, you want to be able to provide and all of that for your woman and all of that. You know what I mean? And things go south. Like I said, maybe, yeah, there definitely needs to be some sort of, for a little while. You know what I mean?
Right. You know, because there's the whole thing with Future and Sierra, where I guess for a while Sierra had full custody of baby Future, and then it went to court recently and
Future actually got custody.
Shared custody. Right. Which is the way it should be.
Yeah.
Unless this man is proven to be dangerous to your child. Like, okay, you know, he's smoking crack around my kid. Mm-hmm. You know, like his house is getting shot up every time. Like my kid's coming back bruised mm-hmm. and fucked up and whatever else.
Goes into alcoholic rages and just starts beating people.
Right, exactly. A man should have joint custody.
Well, a family should be together, first of all.
Family should be together.
That's what the should be. You know what I mean? All of this Band-Aid shit afterwards is after the fact. What should be is that the man and woman should be together. That child, you know what I mean?
Right.
Family unit. Right. And if we want to take it even deeper, according to nature,
okay,
not even just a man and one woman. Oh shit, what did he just say?
Man and multiple women.
That he can take care of.
That he can take care of. Well, in Muslim society, that's exactly how it should be. Well, now, is that not how it should be, but how it is. In fact, in Muslim society, and I've had conversations with Muslims about this, a man is required, a man with money and means is required to have multiple wives. It's actually frowned upon if a wealthy man has just one wife. It's considered selfish that you have all this means and you're deciding just you and this one woman are keeping it all to yourself.
First of all, it's selfish here in America, especially for the black woman, to feel that monogamy is the way to go. Like with all the black men that's getting killed and put in jail and all kind of shit, right? Our numbers is already lopsided. Like there's more women than there are men. Now, if you want for your sister like you want for yourself, if we was to pair off every man with every woman, every black man with every black woman, there'd be so many women that have no man. What they supposed to do? Mm. But your selfish ass want to keep this man just to yourself. Because he's mine, me, because somebody put that into your head.
Right.
Although in not just in Muslim society, in traditional African society, having more than one wife is something that is traditional, no big deal. Like, you know what I mean? Like you said, for some people it's expected.
Yeah.
Okay? So, if anything, monogamy is a selfish concept, especially for our sisters here in North America, mm-hmm. the way the black man is becoming almost extinct, or they'd like him to be extinct. We're never going to be extinct, but what they have to offer, and then let's just say all the men that are out here now, forget the ones that have been killed or in jail. The ratio of alpha males that is out here now is even lower. They're trying to give you beta males. And let me ask you something. In nature, right? The head of the pride, like in a lion's pride, he gets all the women, right? Right? Yep. He gets to fuck all the lionesses. Why? Not because he's a player. Because his DNA and his genetics are the strongest. Mm-hmm. And in order to make that species be able to survive and thrive, the strongest DNA has to be reproduced.
Right. Or you'll have a bunch of lame lions.
That can't hunt. Yeah. That fucking, you know what I mean?
Yeah, they're killed off by the hyenas. Et cetera, et cetera.
And so it's the same concept. You get rid of the strong, dominant alpha males within our culture, and now what you're producing is a weaker man, basically. Is a weaker species.
Right.
Something that's more easily to control. This is how animals get domesticated and all this type of shit.
Right.
Okay? It's the same fucking concept.
Right, because I remember a friend of mine, QD3, we were talking, you know, he was really into raising pit bulls, right? Mm-hmm. Like he, at one point, right, like he actually got so obsessive with breeding pits that he stopped producing for Tupac, so he could just focus on his pits. Yeah. Like that's how heavy he got into it. And we were talking one day about dog fighting, right? And he said that back in the day, when they started fighting pits, the pits that would turn around and attack the masters, you know, their owners.
You gotta kill them.
They would kill them on the spot. Mm-hmm. And they literally killed that trait out of the breed. Mm. That's why when you just don't see pits churning against their owners anymore. Mm-hmm. Because they literally would just shoot them right there and then boom, okay. we don't want that. So you could actually do that. You could actually kill off certain characteristics.
Normal pit bulls are more dog aggressive because, you said, they might have killed out the human aggressiveness out of them. So now they're more dog aggressive. Now they have bully pits. Okay, bully pits are shorter to the ground, a little more stocky, bigger bone. They're not as dog aggressive. They've bred out the dog aggression. So you have the look of a pit bull or a strong fighting dog or whatever, but these dogs are not necessarily dog aggressive. You know what I mean? Unless somebody makes them that way. Sure. You know what I mean? Puts it back into them, but they were specifically bred to take the dog aggression out.
Yeah, I never knew that. Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, my man Daylight actually breeds
Word?
Yeah, he showed me a few pictures. They're kind of crazy looking too. Like,
I think I'm actually in the market for a new dog, man. I lost my boy, and man, I share this, but I think I'm ready now.
You've been to my house before, so you've seen my Rottweiler. Mm-hmm. Once you get I used to have little dogs, but once you get a real dog, you really have a connection with those dogs. Mm-hmm. I definitely feel your pain. Shout out to our sponsor for today's episode of the Vlad Couch, Uber. Having a little extra money in your pocket never hurt anybody. Making it has never been easier when you decide to drive with Uber. Uber is a smartphone app that connects riders with drivers. As a driver, it helps you make extra money driving your own car. Got a busy schedule? You don't have to adjust anything to make more money because Uber lets you make extra money on your schedule. Whenever you need extra money, just turn on the app and drive. A few hours here, a few hours there, and it all adds up really fast. And it's easy to get started. First, go to drivewithuber.com to sign up for free. You can do it right now on your smartphone. Second, answer a few basic questions about you and your car, and then get approved. Third, start driving. That's all there is to it. Start enjoying the flexibility of working when you want to and earning extra money on your schedule. Sign up to Drive with Uber today. Go to drivewithuber.com. That's drivewithuber.com. One more time so you don't forget, drivewithuber.com. So the last time we talked, this news was just breaking. So I decided not to bring it up.
Right.
But now the story has developed, and that is the Africa Bambaataa story. Mm. Now, you actually know personally the first Africa Bambaataa accuser.
Right. I mean, I haven't seen him in years, but Bee Stinger, Ronald Savage, is not just somebody I know. Everybody who used to rock with Zulu Nation and Strong City Records and Studios up at Allerton Avenue knows Bee Stinger.
Hmm. What kind of guy is he?
A very unassuming, you know, I mean, you can see in his interview, slightly nervous energy, but no type of thug, you know, like a kind of guy that's happy to be around type of guy, you know what I mean? But definitely not somebody that I feel would just make up some lies about a motherfucker and then go on TV with the shit and all of this type of
He's
shit.
He's not a grimy type dude.
That's absolutely
a long history of
he got nothing. When you think of Bee Stinger, you just think of a nice guy, like yo, bee stinger. Like, you know what I mean? Like, he's the type of person, if you saw somebody picking on him, you'd want to fucking defend him type of dude.
So, I've interviewed Afrika Bambaataa twice. And in fact, I think in Belgium, when I was DJing, I was on tour, the promoter was friends with Bambaataa, so we all had dinner together, and then, you know, Bambaataa went and DJed, and we hung out. I have nothing negative to say about Bambaataa in terms of my interactions with him.
Me neither.
Super respectful, super nice, actually told me how much he loved my mixtapes and how he would play some of my mixes at his shows. And it was like, oh my God, Afrika Bambaataa, the godfather of hip hop, plays my shit. Like, oh, that was like, you know, winning a Grammy at the time. So for a long time, I chose not to even cover this.
Mm-hmm.
Because out of respect to the man, out of respect to his contribution, and out of my personal experience dealing with him. But ultimately, we have to report on the news. And when it just keeps coming over and over from all these different people. Well, they first issued a statement saying that Bambaataa is no longer part of the Zulu Nation, which is like the equivalent of Steve Jobs getting kicked out of Apple.
Right.
You know what I mean? And then they issued another statement recently. Did you hear about this?
Yes.
Where they issued a formal apology to the alleged victims.
Which was beautiful, because the initial response by some of the, you know, senior members was to attack the...
accusers.
The accusers. The victims.
Are you Zulu?
I mean, technically, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're a part of the Zulu Nation.
I mean, it's not like I'm, you know, paying dues and I could say, yo, I'm down with this chapter and all that. I'm part of the Nation of Gods and Earths. You know what I mean?
Okay.
But kind of by default, by where we started at, you know what I mean? Because we started in that studio on Allerton Avenue with Jazzy J, with a bunch of Zulu dudes.
And Jazzy J Zulu?
Yeah, that was that's the one Bambaataa was handing the records to. Because he was really on a zigga zigga. Red Alert and them was on the zigga zigga.
Okay, so Red Alert is Zulu.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
I know Tribe Called Quest is Zulu.
Yeah, there's a lot of, you know.
Who else? Who are the other prominent Zulu Nation people?
I mean, I don't have a whole list like that. I would assume a lot of like DITC type of, you know what I mean? Because yeah, we all started up there. Showbiz and AG, Diamond D. You know, Law Finesse, dudes like that. Like, these are all people that would be in that Allerton Avenue studio. You know what I mean?
Lil Wayne, I think, was part of the Zulu Nation.
Well, recently
he joined the Zulu Nation.
Q-Tip said that Lil Wayne is down with Zulu Nation. I mean, you know, I got love for Zulu Nation as far as a hip-hop organization, you know, that strive to promote hip-hop and the different elements of hip-hop and put it under one umbrella, that was a beautiful thing.
Right.
You know what I mean? If I find out that the motivation behind that was just so you can have a bunch of little kids around you.
Right.
That'd be some crazy shit. That means we have been Afrika bamboozled, is what the fuck we've been.
Afrika bamboozled.
Okay? Like, seriously.
So at this point, there has been a lot of people coming forward. I remember there was this one video of the street dude from like the Bronx.
I talked to him on the phone, Poppy.
Poppy?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you know him?
I don't know him, but I ended up talking to him on the phone. I was doing another interview with my boys from Harlem, Sonetta,
okay,
and House of Consciousness, Red Pill, Blue Pill.
Okay.
They do kind of what you do, but for the conscious community, you know what I mean? Somehow I was doing it, and they ended up calling Brother Poppy on the phone.
Okay.
So I ended up speaking to Poppy, and I spoke to Big T, the one that beat up Bambaataa. Oh, yeah. Big T was like a bodyguard or something for
Zulu?
For Zulu at one point.
Okay, and he beat up Bambaataa. Why?
Basically, he tells a story about Dad Bam's crib. You know, a lot of times if people watching TV in the front, you know, sometimes people go to the back, Bam's bedroom to watch TV. Now, I don't know, you know, just that's where one of the TVs was at.
Okay.
He said he was back there watching TV. He might have dozed off or something. When he wakes up, he sees, allegedly, I wasn't there, but he told me and other people that he sees Bambada fucking jerking some nigga named Rodney off over there. And so now T is like, what the fuck are you doing? And he said, Bam is like, oh, relax, T, everybody does it, da 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 da. And T got to whooping some ass in that fucking room. You know what I mean? He said he whooped Bambada out for that shit. And like maybe anybody else that was in the room. You know what I mean?
Okay. What did Poppy tell you?
The same. He said, yo, he said that motherfucker is, you know, he said he's a pedophile, period. He's a piece of shit, is what he told me. You know what I mean?
and I saw like the video of Poppy, and this like seemed like a real street dude.
B.O. was like that dude. Azulu, like B.O. had niggas scared on the street. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay.
And from what I understand, they call Poppy Baby B.O.
Okay.
Okay?
So it's a thorough dude.
He's a thorough dude from what I understand. So, I've never met him, but.
So to have someone like that come forward and admit something so embarrassing, shameful, like he's not getting props for this.
At all.
At all. He gets props for having the courage to address his demons, but like on the street, like, you know what I mean? Like he doesn't get a better reputation for this type of thing or whatever. He's not a tough guy.
Yeah. I mean,
or anything, you know, the world that he seems to associate himself with.
This is not something you'd be wanted to readily admit.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So when you hear these stories and you hear the type of people who are telling these stories and, you know, these people aren't gaining anything from this. Aside from a little bit of publicity, which is somewhat negative publicity,
right,
as well. I mean, for example, like you can't pay me to come forward and tell me and say that I got molested by another man, or, you know what I mean? Like there's no paycheck associated with that
I would accept. Offering the money to say this?
Right.
And why?
And why?
Like, are you gonna do this with the hopes that there's a payday at the end of the road on some pie in the sky shit? Let's accuse Bam of this, and then maybe, you know, there'll be $1 million at the end of the road.
Right. I don't think so.
Or, if they are supposedly being paid to do this, then what organization, what person or persons has the money to pay these people whatever they paid them to basically embarrass themselves and say that they were molested by this guy? And why would you go after Bambada? Like, what has he done lately? For hip hop or for anything?
I mean, granted, Planet Rock is an all-time classic song.
Which I didn't like at the time.
You don't like Planet Rock? I love Planet Rock. And Planet Rock was one of the most sampled songs in hip hop of all time.
So what?
Planet Rock was important. Come on. In hip hop, Planet Rock was an important song.
Yes. And listen, I got a whole thing about how hip hop tried to sell its soul from the minute that like the record companies came in.
Okay.
And that was one of the attempts.
Planet Rock was one of the attempts?
That wasn't hip hop. That wasn't the shit that I knew Soul Sonic Force for. I used to listen to the tapes. A totally different experience. And it's funny because I was just talking to Murder Mook the other night, and he gave a good example, a good analogy. Okay, imagine, you know, you want Pepsi, you open the shit, but without looking, you drink it, and then milk is in there. Wouldn't you spit the shit out? Like, that's what the fuck happened when I heard Planet Rock, because it was nothing like the tapes they was making. The tapes they was making was some hardcore hip-hop shit with break beats and all of this type of shit. And they were rhyming like how rappers rhymed at that time. When they came with that Planet Rock shit, it sounded like some experimental, like they were trying to get the white people on board. Okay? And it's like hip hop was trying to do that from the beginning. See, the first hip hop show I ever went to was Soul Sonic Force at Roseland.
Okay.
And when I fought, well, actually the first show downtown, I had been to the Skate Key up in the Bronx. I saw Cold Crush and them. But when I went to that shit in Roseland and I saw fucking Soul Sonic come out and they had those fucking costumes on and shit, this was nothing how I envisioned these dudes in my mind.
Okay.
I was like, what the fuck is this? So I started to realize just recently, because this all ties into the Bambaataa shit, how, okay, if he was doing this, how'd he get away with it for so long? Okay. If he was doing it, that means other people probably knew. And if other people knew, why were they silent? I'll tell you why. Because they were fucking enticed and intoxicated by the prospect of fame and fortune. Especially at that time. Think about it. Like you live in Bronx River. There was no fucking stars that you ever been around. Anybody that made records and was going around the world. All of a sudden, you got a dude that lives right there amongst you. That seems like he might have the key to changing your life.
Right. He could take you on tour.
Like, if you listen to the dude in the second interview, because there was a series of interviews, when this originally came out, when Star had broke all of this, let's keep it, he's the one that broke this. The second dude said he was like a dancer and a rapper and all this type of shit, and he wanted Bam to help him. He said he would have did whatever Bam wanted him to do. Drugs, whatever. Bam wanted to do some homo shit, he did it. How many people had that kind of outlook? Like, not just the ones that he might have molested, but the ones that were covering it up. Because there was plenty of people that was probably eating off of, you know, this whole Zulu Nation shit. And I don't have all their names. I don't know who exactly they are. But if you knew about this shit and you didn't say nothing, you foul.
Right.
And I don't give a fuck how long I've known you. And I probably know some of these dudes personally. You understand? If you knew... Because it's one thing to be gay. Okay, we've been heard this about Bam, that he was gay.
Oh, really?
What? This rumor's been going around for more than 20 years that he's gay.
Okay. Until this happened, I had never heard that.
Man, I heard this 20 years ago.
So what exactly were you hearing?
That Bambaataa's gay.
Okay.
Not that he was a pedophile, that Bambaataa is gay.
Okay.
I heard that years ago. But that's some shit you don't wanna like believe, and you know, it's not like he's doing shit that's outwardly gay that I could see. You know what I mean? Although you can sense certain vibes with people, you know what I mean? And I don't know. We kind of brushed that under the rug and said, I don't see it, so. It's not proven, but I heard it more than once. Then when this shit came out, it was like, whoa. And then when I saw who it was with Bee Stinger and all of that, then when you try to lie and say you didn't know him, I said, well, if you lie about that, so you'll lie about anything.
So you've seen Bee Stinger, was it Ronald Savage?
Bee Stinger, Ronald Savage, in the same room with on multiple occasions with Bambaataa. I'm not talking about no back rooms. I'm talking about in the studio. Matter of fact, I just was talking to one of my mans. I don't know if he wants his name to be said, but one of my mans from back at that time, we were just talking about this Bambaataa shit. And I said, you remember Bee Stinger, right? He said, yeah. I said, and you've seen him in the studio with Bambaataa, right? He said, yo, God, Bambaataa gave me a ride home one night, and Bee Stinger's the one that told me that Bambaataa's gonna give you a ride. I said, get the fuck out of here. Like, I didn't even know that. I don't remember no shit like that. But that's how much we was in the studio. You understand?
Okay, so Bambaataa saying, I don't know who this is.
That's a red flag for me.
That's a lie.
Immediately. There's no way that you did not know who Bee Stinger was. If you call the studio and ask for Jazzy J, he's not around. Who's this, Bee Stinger?
Okay.
There's no way. When you walk straight through the door, he's sitting right there.
Okay.
There's no way. There's other people that are complicit in this. There's other people that enabled, was enablers.
Right.
And made this, created an atmosphere for this to continue.
Right.
And for this to happen.
Yeah, man.
And they're just as guilty.
It's deep. And, you know, because of the way the laws are set up, there's a statute of limitations, so.
Right.
He can't get charged with anything unless it happens.
Unless we found out about some shit that he's done very recently.
Recently, exactly. Mm-hmm. Unless someone comes forward recently.
Mm-hmm. And why would you stop if you've been doing it all this time and never got caught?
Right.
Why would you stop?
Yeah, you'll probably keep going.
Yeah, so maybe we will find some young motherfucker, you know what I mean? That he's been fucking with. Who knows?
Yeah, man. Crazy. Crazy story.
I'm not fucking with that Bam Dusky shit.
Bam Dusky. And you know, Bam actually did a couple interviews defending himself. He did one with Ed Lover, and then he also did one on television defending him. I'm surprised he's even saying anything.
Yeah, and all with people that he thought he was going to be safe with. You know what I mean?
Right.
He's bringing lawyers along. If there's statute of limitations, why you got a lawyer there? Mm. Also, if you run with the Moors, you know, he's supposed to be a Moor. Also, like, he runs with the Moors. So Moors don't fuck with lawyers. They're their own lawyers. Why would you have a lawyer with you?
The Troy Ave situation.
Let's talk about it.
Let's talk about it. When you first heard about it, what was your initial thoughts?
When I first heard that there was a shooting.
Yeah, at Irving Plaza.
At Irving Plaza.
At a TI show.
I was thinking, whew, I almost went to that show. I was thinking, because my man Scram Jones was DJing, and my brother be running with Scram Jones a lot. So Scrams had invited him to that show, but it had started early. So my brother didn't go. Now it turns out one of the guys that got shot in the chest was standing right next to Scrams.
Really?
That could have been my brother.
And he was, I guess, yeah, the guy who got shot.
It came up through the floor or down, either way.
Like down, yeah.
He was not even on that level. He was not even around there when the shit happened. The shit, he was on a totally different floor and get shot in the chest.
Crazy.
That could have been my brother.
Crazy.
But my brother didn't go because Scrams called him to go. And if he went, me and Cooks could have been there too.
Right.
So anyway, so that's the first thing I'm thinking. Well, glad I wasn't there for that. Then you start thinking, all right, what could it be? You know, hopefully it's not T.I. getting in some shit again. You know what I mean? And I know T.I. like, listen, I have nothing to do with this. Indubitably, I have nothing to do with this.
Right.
Then we see the video of Troy bussing. You know, we just hear little bits and pieces of it, and we see him bussing through the door, popping off. Yeah. You know, now the initial thing is, whoa, you just did some crazy shit on camera. You know what I mean? And it appeared that he was being real reckless. As time goes on, you know, but that didn't, that just seemed real crazy. Like, why would he do that?
Right.
So now as time goes on, you start to hear more stories and things that seem like that makes a lot more sense. So now, what we're hearing now is he went from looking like the craziest man in the world to maybe being a fucking hero out here, okay? If what I'm getting, and we're not going to get into no specifics of names and all this type of shit.
Yeah.
But as far as the story I'm hearing, if that's the real story, that make a lot more sense. Is that he got in a beef with an individual, they tussle, the individual's man pulls out a gun, pops his man, pops Troy Ave in the leg or whatever the case may be. Somehow in the melee, either he's struggling for the gun or the gun just gets on the floor. He picks up the gun now and chases an individual and starts popping at him. Now, what's wrong with that? Now, legally, We're not even gonna talk about that. But just on some real nigga shit, like that's exactly what I would have done. I'm not thinking that there's no fucking cameras. If I just saw you shoot my man and you just shot me and now I got a hold of the gun, you're not thinking about all these people. And first of all, I don't know who was on the other side when he was popped. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know how many people was around. I saw him let off one. It was like 3 or 4 shots that happened before that. That seemed like that was the initial shit. Yeah. So they try to make it seem like he was just bah, 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 bah. Nah. And even they said it was all the same gun. Yeah, it could have been the same gun.
Right. That gun, I guess, was fired 5 times.
Right, but not necessarily by the same individual.
Right. We don't know yet.
We don't know yet. And that's what I'm saying. We got to put it all together, but not necessarily. You see, you say it could have been or could have not been. I don't know. But the story I'm hearing, it makes a lot more sense. And if that's the case, well then, y'all like live shit. Y'all like real niggas and all of that. Well, there goes some real nigga shit right there. He just did some real shit.
The Troy Ave situation.
Saw his man get hit. Got shot in the leg, had the presence of mind to pick up the gun, calmly walk through the door and start popping. I'm sorry. Like, that's the type of shit that real motherfuckers is taught to do. Now, from a legal standpoint, he's fucked, because even if that did happen, once you start to pursue a motherfucker, you're fucked. You could be getting attacked. If that shit would have, and then you would have defended yourself right at that moment. Once your attacker is fleeing,
yeah,
and you decide to chase this motherfucker,
right,
and do what you do, then on a legal standpoint, that's where you're fucked.
Well, I remember when I lived in New York, and this was recently, of course, when I got my gun license, they explained to me, like, for example, and I didn't have a carry permit, I just had a home permit. They explained to me, if someone breaks into my house and I pull my gun out and they turn around and try to run out the door and I shoot them in the back,
right,
I would be charged with murder.
Exactly.
It doesn't matter if they had a gun, if they shot at me first.
It's just like we was talking about the pits, okay? Like, I was doing the personal protection training shit with the dogs, okay? So now, if you got your dog, if somebody's coming at you,
yeah,
and you say, listen, keep fucking with me, I'm gonna let this dog go, and they come at you, you have every right to let that dog go and tell them, listen, the person, you warned them too.
Right.
But now if they come at you, do whatever, they could even hit you or whatever, and then run away.
Right.
If you now let the dog go and say, go get him, now you're fucked. You're getting prosecuted, regardless. Now street rules, go get him.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Street rules, Troy Ave did what he was supposed to do if what I'm hearing is what happened. You see what I'm saying? If what I'm hearing happened, if that's the real story, then I agree with what he did. If he was recklessly shooting off in the club, then I don't agree with that. You know what I mean? But I don't think that's what he was doing.
Well, it's a crazy situation because on top of that, and this is something we reported on, when Troy was dropped off at the hospital, they found 3 guns.
Right, one is not. Yeah,
one of which was the gun that was doing the shooting. So they found the smoking gun, literally.
Okay.
In a hidden compartment. So now you have the gun charges on top of this. And, and I'm sure all those guns are illegal because Troy doesn't have a carry permit and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Like, it's just a very sad situation all around.
Absolutely.
And I don't know what happened. I don't know the cause of it. We, of course, all hear the rumors, but I don't know what happened.
I don't either.
And at the end of the day, it doesn't sound like it was all that serious for the outcome to be what this is.
Right.
And I feel that people are so much more sensitive than they have to be. And the one thing that I've learned about the internet, I mean, because me and my man Stretch had a conversation about this once, about how, like, I personally like the internet because it's caused me personally to get a thicker skin over being insulted.
Mm-hmm.
I get called all sorts of names on the internet every day on my own site, in the comments of my own YouTube channel. You get the same thing.
I had to grow some dermis.
Right. You know, and what my man explained to me, he said that before the internet, you would react, let's say, violently when someone would say these things to you because it would usually be done in person and there was a threat of violence to go along with that. If someone would call you a faggot or whatever, you assume that this person is going to also be attacking you physically, so sometimes you have to attack first. But on the internet, you know that this is someone in another country, in another part of the world, whatever else, and there's no way to even know who it is, much less get back at them. And you have to sit back and say, you know, it's not that serious. It's just words. It's just words. The person is just talking. It's easy to do. It's fun to talk. People like to talk. Jerry Seinfeld said that. People like to talk. They like to hear themselves talk.
I see, but words have energy too.
Words have energy, but
whole wars have been started from words.
This is true, but I feel like the internet has caused people to just get a better perspective on it.
For people like you and I, but for some people, they're not just going to automatically grow that skin. They might get more hateful. Like, the internet is a hateful place, yo.
It is.
It's a very hateful place. Like you got people out there just hating just for hate's sake.
All right.
Like, and not everybody's not created equally. Everybody doesn't have the same defense mechanisms or able to compartmentalize something and say, you know what, that's just the internet, da 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 da. Like, some people, when they're attacked, they just feel attacked. Like, you know what I mean? And it doesn't matter if it's the internet or in person and all of that. Like, for us, yes, it's helped us to grow with shit like that. But not for everybody, man. You can't necessarily take your experience with it and apply it to everybody. But yes, you know, because at first, when you first started getting the hate, how did you feel?
Upset.
You know what I mean? Like, when I first started getting it, I'm ready to go. Motherfucker, meet me here. Motherfucker, like, I'll listen. Right. But then it's like, come on, man. You can't answer every motherfucker that talks shit. Like, and then you find out what a troll is. Because I didn't even know what a troll was. Like, what is a troll? Like,
right. Because the way me and you even linked up was you had said certain things about Kanye on your Twitter account.
Mm-hmm.
And I picked up on it. And then I brought you into the YouTube arena, which was a whole different place.
And I wasn't trying to troll Kanye. I'm just talking out loud, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I'm not here to troll. But then I started getting trolls, and I didn't even know what trolls was. So I'm thinking, like, fuck you, bitch. You know what I mean? Like, your mother sucks mad dick. That, you know what I mean? That's what I'm writing back to motherfuckers. Like, but then I'm like, yo, leave this shit alone, man. This shit ain't. You ain't got to respond. Now I don't give a fuck. I don't even read the comments.
I don't give a fuck. Actually, when they come to my platform to talk shit about me, I just basically hit a button and make sure that they can't comment on my shit no more. That's it. Because
And then they talk shit about that.
They talk shit about that.
He erased all the comments. I see.
Yeah, exactly. But my whole thing is, you know, and then people send me the emails like, yo, this is freedom of speech. How dare you block me from commenting?
This is my fucking site.
No, this is my shit.
It's not American.
You coming? You a guest in my house? Go ahead and go on your own Twitter account.
Talk all the shit.
Talk
about
all
me
the shit
you want
all day long. I can't do nothing.
Come
about
on my site that I fucking pay for,
right?
And talk shit about me and think I'm gonna leave it up there. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. So, well, look, I don't know what's gonna happen. I don't know what the facts in the case are. It's very early in the whole situation. It seems like that the internet is like This is almost the first time you see the internet band together to become the private investigators for the police. It's crazy.
And that's and motherfuckers got to be careful, you see? Because they'll get on the internet and start giving, you know, information, you know, that's not necessarily, like, the police could conduct their investigation by reading shit on the internet.
Right, and a lot of this stuff is not accurate.
Right.
A lot of the stuff, you know, because I remember the initial stuff was like, you know, because even, and even like
in
the media.
Another rapper's name in it. Right, no, I'm not even going to get
Well, no, I mean, we actually could speak about that because he actually spoke about it himself.
And right, he was like, we had a great working relationship.
Right, it was Mano. Because it was like there was a beef between Mano and Troy Ave. And I'm like, I never heard that. So I actually called Mano up. I said, yo, he's like, yo, this is completely false. He's like, he posted up a picture of him with arm around Troy Ave. Like, yo, this is...
Because I'm thinking the main, like, Brooklyn need to stick together right now. So the main Brooklyn dudes would be Uncle Murder, Mano, and Troy Ave. Like, that would be, you know, and then I was thinking, well, when they first said that, I was like, was Troy Ave maybe feel a kind of way because Mano and Uncle Murder is kind of... Voltroning up right now, maybe, you know, I'm trying to figure it out. You trying to figure it out in your mind type of shit. And it was like, that don't make sense. Like, why would, you know what I mean? Shit I'm hearing now make a lot more sense. But I'm not doing the police job for them. You know what I mean? Let these motherfuckers figure it out. All I know is I kind of like Troy Ave a little more now. I'm not going to lie. Like, I kind of liked him before, but I like him more now. It's going to make me look back at his catalog and all that and shit. I bet you his sales might be up right now, or at least his streams.
Well, Troy Ave will have his day in court, or he'll have his plea deal. Either or.
If he gets off with this somehow, he gets off, oh, he's going to be a fucking legend. He's going to fucking watch. Watch. If he gets off and then can use the footage, that footage in a video or some shit, oh my goodness.
Listen up, because we need help to keep putting out the show you love for free every week. Look, nobody likes filling out surveys, but we need you to do it. It won't take any more than 5 minutes, and besides helping out the show, you'll be entered for a chance to win a $100 iTunes gift card. We know some of you have already done surveys like this in the past, but we really need you to log in and fill this thing out as accurately as possible. Once we know more about you, we'll be able to help deliver the show and sponsors you dream about. Finding sponsors who are a good fit means that we get to give you deals and information on the brands that you care about while keeping the shows free to enjoy every week. If you don't care about helping us or making the show better, do it for a chance to win the free iTunes or Amazon gift card. So please, do us a solid and go to the VladCouchSurvey.com. Again, that's the VladCouchSurvey.com. What did you think about the New York police commissioner referring to rappers as thugs and that?
Faggot shit. He's just trying to, you know what I mean? He's just trying to throw motherfuckers under the bus because he got a beef with, you know, probably an ongoing beef with hip-hop and just... Black people in general, like, come on, man. Yeah, like, shit like this always happens. Like, no, it don't. Some shit like this hasn't happened in a while, like, if you ask me. Like, I can't remember last real hip-hop shit that I showed that I've been to and motherfuckers start shooting and shit like that.
Yeah, I don't remember last time this happened in... I mean, in Manhattan especially. I don't remember. The tunnel, maybe. I mean, were people getting shot at the tunnel? Or was it more of a stabbing thing?
Well, they get shot outside the tunnel, you know. Yeah, all kinds of shit would happen at the tunnel, matter of fact.
Exactly.
But yeah, like, come on, man. Yeah, that was just trying to get that, put that out in the air. Just trying to put some negative shit about hip-hop into the air and trying to reinforce stereotypes in the minds of certain people.
Do you think that the word thugs really meant something else?
Of course. These are all code words. Huh. They don't call young white kids who run around doing some shit thugs. Like, thug is a code word for nigger, basically. thug, animals is another code word they'll use. They were acting like animals. They never say that about, you know, let a you know, like when white people win a championship and they tear up their fucking their college campus or some shit like that, or their city. They don't fucking say, bands of thugs were wilding out. They'll say, oh, excited students, you know, got a little rambunctious last night, flipped over a few cars, burned a few things down, but
raped a few women. That's just kids.
They're just kids. Boys being boys. But yeah, these thugs, these animals, these whatever, you know, label they want to put you on you besides saying these niggers.
So we recently did an interview with Lil Boosie.
Okay. Getting that paper, huh?
And this interview actually went viral. It got like a million views in like 5 days. It's crazy. And what Boosie talked about was kind of interesting.
I had haters out there. And it's always like that. Wherever you from, you will get hated the most. You know, most rappers die in their own city, man. It's a fact. And, you know, you have haters who was in school with you and they mad because they was in that third grade class with you, but they don't have the same hustle as you.
Because I thought, okay, this is, you know, Boosie does about 100,000, 150,000 each clip. This one did a million, like quick. And everyone started putting up like the Instagram video from Rico Love to, you know, the Academics to, you know, Shade Room and everything. Like, you know, like the Instagram video started going everywhere.
Because
and,
it's mad, it's so true. Like they talk about, you left the hood and all that. Like, you can't become rich and stay in the hood. Like, it's almost disrespectful. How are you going to build a mansion right next to where people are starving?
Okay, well, I don't think he built his mansion in the hood.
I'm giving you an example. Okay. You understand what I'm saying? This is an analogy.
Okay.
You say he doesn't have to build his fucking mansion. Just being in the same city with these people is damn near the same thing. You understand what I'm saying? But I'm just saying, literally, if you were to try to do something like that, build you a mansion right next to the projects, you can't, because you are smearing your success, or what appears to be your success, in the face of a bunch of people who don't have it. You know what I mean? And jealousy, envy, lust, hate, these are the four devils. These are the devilish character flaws that allow people to murder, steal, rape, do all the bullshit that we experience in society. Jealousy, envy, lust, hate. So, and it's a shame that you will experience these things by the people that are most familiar to you.
Right.
Like, the people that are right around you are the ones that you'll end up having to deal with a lot of this shit with. Like, when you get in this game or whatever game, you become successful, it's not, a lot of times it's not you that changes, it's the people around you. Their perception of you changes. You're still the same dude.
Right.
But now they're looking at you differently. Before, you was just homie around the way, you wasn't no meal ticket to them, or no, you know?
Yeah.
Now, it's like you're the threshold between life and death for some of these people. Like you could change somebody's life, but you choose not to, right?
Right, that one chain you got, you know, I could pay my rent for a year with that, but you rock it, or you gonna get another chain.
Man, I saw him blow 50,000 in the club last night. Like he got it.
He got it.
You know what I mean? He could have gave me that 50,000.
Right, because I actually interviewed AZ Faison. You know who that is?
Who?
AZ, he You saw the movie Paid in Full?
Yeah. Oh, come on, AZ. That's my dude. I know AZ.
Okay, so personally. There you go. Yeah. So AZ, not the rapper AZ.
I know AZ, the real AZ.
The real AZ, yeah, yeah, right. So AZ.
Mob style,
mm-hmm. Exactly. So I interviewed him, and he described the situation of how he got shot 9 times.
Mm-hmm. I got shot in the head twice, man, and 5 people was in that situation with me. You know, 3 people died, and 3 people lived. I knew exactly who one cat was.
Okay.
I knew, you know, the cat, Kevin Clark. I knew it was him.
The boy, your sister's boyfriend.
Yeah, I knew it was him.
The craziest part of the whole story is, like, you just gave this guy a car. You just gave this guy, like, more money than he's probably ever held in his life. And this is the same dude that turns around and tries to kill you and kills the people around you? Like, yo, like, what do they say? No good deed goes unpunished?
Exactly. Because when you unsatisfied, when you're dissatisfied, it doesn't matter. You see, it doesn't matter. I could give you, you know, I could give you a Maybach. Nah, fuck, why didn't you give me the Bugatti? Like, you know what I mean? Like, right. You just never satisfied, are you, you piece of shit? And that's the problem. Like, at some point, you have to find satisfaction. Like, there's only 360 degrees.
Right.
And if you believe that there's 366 degrees, you're going to keep striving for something that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
And that's the illusion. They're trying to make us believe that there's an extra 6 degrees, and that 6 degrees is 6 degrees of separation.
Right.
That's what separates us, because we believe that we can get this extra shit that is not even real.
Yeah. And, you know, for example, like, he told me about the situation of how Lulu got killed.
Who?
Lulu was his connect. Was it the Spanish dude, okay, who was giving him all the coke?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he thinks the reason why Lulu got killed was he was fronting a lot of people work, right? So, you know, he thinks that, like, someone who he had fronted, like, let's say $1 million worth of cocaine to, figured out that it'd be easier just to kill him and keep this $1 million as opposed to pay him back and get some more work. And that's how he thinks Lulu got killed. And it's just crazy. It was like this dude's doing good business with you. I mean, not that I agree with the drug business, but it is what it is. But that's what happened based on his mm-hmm. educated guess, was that someone that he had fronted some work to felt that it was easier. Okay, he owes Lulu $1 million. It'd be easier to give this dude 10 grand to go kill him, and now I got $990,000 mm-hmm, as opposed mm-hmm. to $200,000 in profit.
Crazy.
It's crazy.
That's how it works, though. You know. So, yeah, I agree with that move, Boosie. Like, if you got to move to Atlanta,
Have you experienced that yourself? I mean, once, you know, because you grew up in the hood in Brooklyn. I mean, when you started...
I grew up in New Rochelle.
New Rochelle, my bad.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I don't know. Let's see, I didn't...
You didn't stick around long enough?
Not really, like, because I always wanted to move
yeah.
from up there. Like when you're young, New Rochelle just seems like a fucking boring place to live. Like, I always wanted to be in the city and all that type of shit. So as soon as I got a chance to move to the city, I'm out of here. You know what I mean? Now that you get older and shit, and you have a family, and you're like, damn, New Rochelle's not a bad place to live. Like, I might would move back up there, actually, now and shit. But I experienced lightweight, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Lightweight hate, but I wasn't even, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not even, nah, it wasn't like that. And it's not like we was, you know, millionaires or some shit like that. You know what I mean? We was just doing our thing. And at the time, we was trying to pull in as many people as possible. Like,
right.
We used to be rolling like 100 deep sometimes to shows. You understand what I'm saying?
So you never had none of the dudes around you that you try to help out end up churning against you? I've had a little bit of that in my time.
I mean, I guess so. Yeah. Or they might have said little slick shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? To somebody else, and then it gets back to you. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? Like, oh. So they hating, even though he want to still be with me. Okay, I get crazy. It. It's all good.
Yep.
I see it.
Yep. Sad. I interviewed Mano recently. And we talked about designer.
As far as the sound, I don't know what the sound is of New York today. Like, what is it? What's the sound? Like, now, if we want to talk about the boom bap sound, I think that's we don't have that no more. I mean, you got certain artists that touch it a little bit. You know, you got, you know, brothers like Joey Badass and them, you know, that touch it. You got a lot of, you know, some of the older artists that, you know, that still touch that. But I don't know if that's the premier sound of my city no more. I think that we have been influenced by other markets and other cultures.
Point was, is there really a New York sound anymore? And the reason why Future is able to do this, to come out of Brooklyn and do this.
It's a designer. You just said Future, but.
Future, see, it's crazy. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. you see what just happened? I even mixed them up. And it's not like designer even tries to deny it, because I remember I was on designer's Instagram page and he had like a box of, like, you know, butter. And it said, I can't believe it's not Future. You know, like, I can't believe it's not butter.
That's
like,
hilarious.
And it had a picture designer on the
right.
On the box cover. It's pretty funny. I mean, how do you feel as a New York rapper when you have, right now, designer, I almost said Future again. Designer is the first male New York rapper to have a number one song since Jay-Z with Empire Mind State. Mm. No, and you know, there's been some prominent New York rappers since then, you know, French Montana hasn't had a number one song since then. 50 Cent has not had a number one song, you know, since then. But who am I forgetting? Who are some other big New York rappers?
Right now?
Yeah, see what I'm saying? You know, Mano's had a couple of hits and so forth, but since then, Fabulous has not had a number one song since then. So that's what I'm talking about. Designer is the first male New York rapper that's had a number one song in, like, Empire Mind State was, what, 7-8 years ago?
Right.
Like, as a New York rapper, what do you think about that?
Well, first of all, when they say, is there a New York sound, I don't think it's just about, like, the boom bap. I feel like New York dudes talk how I talk. Meaning we don't talk like this here, okay? We ain't talking about with all the twang and the voice and all that type of shit there.
Right.
You see what I'm saying, though?
Right.
We don't talk like that there.
Right.
We talk like this here. You know what I'm saying? That's the New York sound. Okay. So when you got dudes who are now switching their voice up, that's what gets a little confusing. Now, it's one thing to use like a down south twang, I guess, to try to pull in the down south people. To me, I trace it back to like 50 Cent. He was like the first one that I can think of who was from New York, but used like a Cali slight twang to his rhymes and shit like that. Find me in the club, bottle full of bub. You need to get a rub. That ain't no New York pronunciation.
And, you know, and 50 Cent was signed to a West Coast label.
Exactly. So,
Shady Aftermath.
He knew what the fuck he was doing.
Yeah.
But, that being said, your boy Designer is going, he sound, I got bras in Atlanta. Like he sound like he from down there.
Right.
I guess it wouldn't be so bad if he could really rap. But I saw his Tim Westwood freestyle, and he was horrible. He was horrible.
I didn't understand it. Like, I didn't quite understand what he was saying.
Because, and that's what I'm saying, it was horrible. Like, see, we're at the point now, like, if you want to pop, if you want to be popping, I guess you got to do some Southern type shit.
I don't agree.
I mean, for some, I don't know. It's hard.
I just don't agree. In any art form, I don't feel that when you chase after what's popular, you will never end up on top. You'll always be chasing after, you'll always be below that person who originated that.
Yeah, but some people don't want to be all the way on the top. They don't mind being just close to the top. They was down here before. So if I can get up here, that's good for me.
Okay.
You understand what I'm saying?
I guess so. It's never been my mentality. My mentality is you go for the number one spot. And, get somewhere close to there. I'm cool with that. You know what I'm saying? It's mm-hmm. like when I went into the mixtape game, it was like, I'm going to do my own shit. Like, I'm going to do it my way. I don't give a fuck how many other people are doing it. I don't care what everyone else is doing. I'm doing it my way. And then, boom, I got all my awards and I got all my recognition and everything else like that by doing my own shit. I didn't give a fuck how crowded the playing field was. I'm going to do my own shit. J. Cole was not trying to sound like anyone else when he came out. He was doing his own shit. He was not fucking with the hottest producers. He was not getting the hottest features. He was doing his own shit. And people love J. Cole because he's doing J. Cole. And he didn't win any Grammys, which I thought was highway robbery.
Yeah.
But he's still doing his fucking thing. And I think he's okay with that.
Yeah, but he's also an anecdotal story. Like, there's not a bunch of J. Coles out there. Like, you know what I mean?
Well,
like,
I mean, Kendrick Lamar is kind of like a J. Cole. I put him in the same category.
Yeah. But then, like, I know I've heard Kendrick at least rhyme on some 808 shit. I don't know if I've heard J. Cole rhyme on any kind of 808 beats.
Yeah.
And that being said, when you're rhyming over some 808 shit, then you're doing what a lot of people's doing right now. You know what I mean? Even mm-hmm. if you do it slightly different. Yeah, I hear what you're saying, though, but I don't know. All that New York, I mean, there is a New York sound traditionally.
Yeah.
We don't usually rock with the twang and all that, but I see some people doing it in a scientific kind of way.
Right.
And it could work for them.
Jermaine Dupri, who really is one of the greatest musical producers ever. He doesn't get, I just interviewed Bow Wow recently. We talked about how he doesn't nearly get the recognition that he deserves because this man is responsible for hundreds of millions mm-hmm. of albums sold, mm-hmm. including Mariah Carey and, everything. He played them back to back and he was showing how the Panda beat was similar to Future's Comma beat.
Right.
And you can deny it all you want, but this is a musical genius telling you this.
Right, like he can hear it.
he can hear it. He even played them, he would mix the two with each other because Jermaine Dupri DJs a lot. Mm. So how do you feel as a New York rapper when the biggest New York rapper right now is emulating an Atlanta rapper from the rap style to the music style?
First of all, he's not the biggest New York rapper, though. Just because you got a number one song don't make you the biggest rapper.
Right now,
there we go.
At this very moment, based on popularity, based on that one song.
He got a hot song. He's not the hottest rapper.
Okay.
There's a difference.
How do you feel about the New York rapper with the hottest song right now?
How do I feel that he's emulated someone from down south in order to do it?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying.
Like I said, if he could really rhyme, then maybe I wouldn't have a problem with it. Like if he was dope. Like I'm gonna tell you right now. You know who Graf? You heard of Graf?
Of course.
Now Graf could really rhyme.
Yes.
That boy got a song right now called Trap Phone Ringing. When I tell you this shit is a fucking smash hit, trap phone ringing. But he's doing the down south style. Like when I first heard it, I thought it was a nigga from the dirty, dirty, dirty. And this is a New York dude. But why I respect it is because I know Graf can rhyme for real.
Yeah.
So that's almost like he's just showing you I could do that shit. But at the same time, he's not necessarily trying to sound like another rapper and all this. And this song is just button. I'm telling you, this song's going to do something.
It's okay.
Gonna be big.
I'm going to check it out.
Trust me. So that's an example where if you got a guy that can really rap and he does that, I'm not mad. But when you got a guy like this designer dude who's just, he just stumbled onto some shit, because from what I hear, you know, I heard his follow-up, that was horrible. You know what I mean? I can't really understand you on your first hit, but you did make a hit. Was mad catchy, I can't front. I see what it does in the clubs, but I just feel like he can't really rhyme. So I don't know, I got no respect for it. I got no respect for it, you know what I mean?
Lil' Kim, someone recently accused her of bleaching her skin. Mm. And she fired back. She said, okay, when the fuck did I bleach my skin, you miserable moron? You know, she called the person a hater. Facts are right in front of your face. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This is Lil' Kim right now.
I'm saying, maybe that's the lighting though. Plus with the blonde hair, you know, and the lights, you know, like, I'm really dark skinned, but look at these lights, you know, they make me look lighter.
You don't look like this. I can have all the lights in the world. I can put the sun in front of you. You won't quite look this light. Have you met Lil' Kim?
Yeah.
Like back in the day?
Yeah.
She's fairly dark skinned.
Well, she was brown. She's brown.
Darker than you?
Probably. Yeah.
A few shades darker.
Yeah.
Based on, there's a lots of videos and everything else like that. Do you feel that Lil' Kim lightened her skin?
I mean, I know she's done a lot of things to herself that a lot of us who love her believe she shouldn't have done. You know what I mean? I'm not keeping track of every procedure that she's having, but when you show me that picture right there, yeah, that looked like a much lighter Kim than I knew, or than we all knew when she first came out. I mean, pull up her first little Kim when she's squatting like that. Mad dudes got that etched in their brain, and I know she wasn't that light.
It was hardcore?
Yeah. Lil' Kim hardcore. Come on, she's much more browner in those pictures. Mm-hmm. I mean, she looks light there, but she's not that light. You know what I mean? She's brown. She's brown there.
Right. And I actually thought Lil' Kim was pretty.
She was.
When she first came out.
The one with the blue hair right there, that's the Kim.
That's the Kim I know.
We used to love.
Right. Pretty girl.
Sexy too.
Sexy, you know, great rapper.
But I don't think she believed. You see, she didn't believe that. So it doesn't matter what we thought.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And now it's like, I mean, I can still tell that's her, but it's like she don't look nothing like how she started out at. And I just seen her at the Bad Boy concert at the Barclays Center.
Okay, so you saw her there?
Yeah, I was there both nights. So I seen her. Seen it.
She look a lot different?
She don't look like the Kim from the Biggie days, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
She looked like a whole, you know, somebody different.
I think that the biggest tragedy of today's plastic surgery epidemic, and I've actually seen this myself, is that you have girls who have great natural bodies.
Mm-hmm.
Great, like curvaceous, you know, thick, like, you know, beautiful, beautiful women who go and get plastic surgery to try to compete with the freak shows that are dominating Instagram and the strip clubs and that
circuit.
Mm-hmm. Like, I've seen it. Like, I actually know a girl who did this.
Right.
And I was like, yo, why? And I remember she was telling me about it, and I'm like, yo, don't, what are you, crazy? Like, yo, don't do it. And then she did it, and now she's talking about how it wasn't enough, so she's going to do it again. And I'm just like, yo, like the one thing you had over all these other girls
was your
naturalness. Like, you stood out because of that. And now you try to join their ranks? When... Like, I think they all look fucked up, you know? Me personally, I don't like fake asses. I don't like fake titties. I don't like liposuction. I don't like all that type of stuff. You know, that's just me. A lot of dudes like it. That's fine. That's their business. But you see these girls who are literally fucking up great natural bodies because they can't compete with the freak shows.
Well, first of all, you know, I was thinking about just artificial period. Like, I think why we're so accepting of a lot of this artificial shit is because most of the time we're putting, you are what you eat. So you're putting artificial shit in your body all the time since birth.
Right.
Since birth, you've been eating artificial foods and, you know, colorings and flavors and this and everything's artificial. So why not? Like, why not your hair be artificial? Your eyes, your titties, your ass. Because it all goes back to what I said. Like, you're not satisfied with yourself. That and your, or your, it's also part of arrogance that you believe that you're smarter than nature. That you know better than nature. Nature gave me this ass. Nature gave me this gender. Oh, no. I know better than nature. I know I'm supposed to be a woman. I know I got a dick between my fucking legs. But I'm supposed to be a woman. Or my titties, they just grew to here. No, my titties are supposed to be a Z, 36Z. Like, come on, yo. Be satisfied. Find some satisfaction out here. Because that's part of the problem. Is dissatisfaction. That's what leads to all the bullshit. Why would Bambada fuck with little boys? Because he's dissatisfied with pussy. You see what I'm saying? Why would, you know, why would somebody kill you to try to get your money? Because they're dissatisfied with their life and they want what you have.
Right.
Dissatisfaction is a motherfucker. So we got to find a way to be satisfied with the great and perfect things that we have in our life. I'm saying be satisfied with, especially with the things nature gives you.
Right. Did you hear about the whole big boy thing?
Big boy
from Big Outkast? Big boy from Outkast. Yeah, he posted up this meme. And it's mothers in the 70s, mothers now, and we act like we don't know what's wrong with these kids.
Oh, yeah, okay. Mothers in the 70s like Florida.
Yeah.
Mothers
yeah.
Now hanging off of shower poles.
With the kids, with the kids watching.
Oh, I didn't even see the kids in
here. Yeah, there's a kid. There's a kid watching.
Wow.
And he got all this backlash. Over this.
Why?
Not quite sure why. Because it seems perfectly
rational. Oh, perfectly you rational thought shaming?
Thought shaming.
You thought shaming, big boy? How dare you thought shame? Fuck out of here. Keep that shit going, big boy.
Right. Because, you know, for example, like when Ayesha Curry, you know, Steph Curry's wife,
mm-hmm.
when she, like, talks about being wholesome and... you know, women not exposing, and like everyone trashes her for it, right. And everything else like that. And it's like,
that's how you know we're living in the last days. Like when they could try to shame somebody who is
trying to preach wholesomeness,
modesty,
right? And if you look at Ayesha Curry, she got two beautiful kids. Her husband is very successful. She's got her own cooking show, et cetera, et cetera. She's not out there. She's out on the internet, but she's not out there promoting some fuck shit.
Right. But then you have the Kardashians of the world.
Yeah.
You see, that'll put their titties and asses out anywhere and fuck with this one and that one and make porns to be famous and all this type of shit.
Right.
And they're the ones that, you know.
They get lip injections at 17.
And they get all the light.
Yeah.
Yet the positive sisters that's trying to be like, yo, you need to fall back. Like, have some respect for yourselves.
Right.
They get shitted on.
They get shitted
on. So now big boys out here trying to send a message of positivity. And, oh, you're going to blame the blame the sluts. You slut shaming, slut blaming.
Slut shaming. Yeah, and then, you know, people started like talking about his various lyrics about calling women hoes and stuff like that. You know, I'm trying to say he's hypocritical about the whole thing.
So maybe he came to a realization.
Yeah, because he has children of his own.
Right. You can't necessarily hold me for everything that I might have said when I was 21 years old and now I'm 40-something years old. That's like, you know what I mean?
Right.
That's like me holding, you know, some shit you did in kindergarten. I'm so, oh, remember back in kindergarten when you put the finger paint on the wall? Like, now I'm scared that you're going to do that right now. Like, come on, B. Like, that shit don't even make no sense.
Crazy.
Like, we all grow all the time. That's part of life. We're changing as we speak right now. We're not the same people we were at the beginning of this interview.
Exactly.
So, fuck out of here.
Exactly. Jamar, always a pleasure, man. My man.
Yes, sir, Vlad.
Gucci's absolutely the boogeyman of hip-hop. Like, it's just certain individuals you just know that at any given moment, it could go left.
Right.
Gucci's one of them. T.I. is one of them. I told y'all that before. I don't know why y'all keep acting like T.I. ain't Gucci level crazy.
Maybe T.I. Gucci, is Gucci level crazy.
Gucci might be T.I. level crazy.
You mean to tell me that if I walked up to your mother right in front of you and shot her in the face, and then I left the country, and you can't get to me, you wouldn't tell the police?
Hell no, where your mama stay at?